Okay. It seems to me I'm unraveled. Tied up, it seems to me I'm unraveled. You're on the beach at the water's edge. A wave comes in, and as it withdraws, it sucks with it some of that sand. Paradoxically, it is the fact of your solid presence, your being just here, genders and enables the undercutting of the ground on which you stand. All waves arrive, one, another, another. You totter and must move. Increasingly, I don't know what I'm saying, what to say, how to say what I don't know what I want to say. Not increasingly, really. Always the tongue in its tower totters, stutters, stammers. Alash, alash. Maybe yes, maybe no. Lady Strauss was it used to be that what I said, the sound that came from my mouth, my sound, was the best, truest, most accurate guide to my thoughts and feelings. But that was a long time ago. And even at the time he said it, I already didn't believe him. The truth was always to be found, not in me, but in the reverberation, the complementary, the storms, and the sympathetic vibrations left amongst the surrounding resonant bodies, in the hubbub, in the murmur, in the feedback, in the carivari and the pop bashing, in and out of the noise. Part of what comes, always and insistently, with the acknowledgement of this truth, is a recognition that we are not dealing with the individual and, which is to say, over against the whole, but with the one as agent within the collective. Juxtaposition, contact, joint and separate coexistence, layering, exchange, alteration, connection, disjunction. Somebody tries to teach you to speak in a tongue which, though a part of my tongue, does not come easily. The edge of a ruler brought down hard and repeatedly on my knuckles, and the blackboard rubber that, when I fail to duck fast enough, catches me glancing blow after blow, does nothing to hasten the processes of familiarization and assimilation. Nonetheless, something stiff and persists, and buried in the scraps is this understanding of the way things alter as they come into shifting relation with the material, the breathy flesh, and the words of the world. We're taught this as a decline, a falling away, a contraction of subjective self-sufficiency, autonomy, power and control over the state of things. By and through the operation of this decline, an order is imposed, following a hierarchy that is proposed and proposes itself as natural, immutable. A declension, nominative, subject, named, the entitled, the agent, the entitled agent, the actor, the thrown up. Addressing the receiver, they who are in receipt or receivership, the listener, they who hear, they who see, they who are obliged, accusative, object, they or it whose existence is always on trial, cannot be taken for granted, they who are guilty until proved innocent, the thrown against. Genitive, of, sexuality, procreativity, creativity, possession, possessiveness, origin, analysis. Dative, to or for, the given, gift, generosity, responsibility, debt. Ablative, by, with or from, the proximal, the distant, gender and relation to each other and to actions. Identify number, gender and relation in any instance is a part of parsing, an act described by M. Noble St. Philip as the exercise of dismembering language into fragmentary cells to create the remember. I want to attempt to reflection of what it might be to remember, and to do this with the assistance of what Fred Moten has described as the shadow of a parallel dimension, something that enables, as he says, the re-consideration of significant objects that attempts to validate what could be called the changes that an object enacts and demands. And by object, he has in mind something like the jazz ensemble and its sound, or the poet and its sound, or their inter-inanimation and political implications. I've become caught and bound up in a strange knot, strange like a granny, which should be a reef, but which got twisted and turned around and against its original sense and flow somewhere in the middle. One thing laid upon another and then folded over and under, and then those over under threads folded back over under again. Sometimes it's called the lover's knot, the knot to someone who does not know how to live by and on and with and in the sea. It doesn't hold fast, it slips when caught under strain, undoes, unravels. I'm bound up and I am unravelled. This particular knot comes about as a result of translation and error. On one side, the loss of a consonant is implicated in loss from and of a consonant, and, pressingly, loss of life, which is to say, murder. On the other, the translation substitutes a new vowel for one that has become familiar. The sound of impending death jumps from the opening of my auditory and lexical landscape to its conclusion, from alpha to omega. Attention an accident, attention as that which is visible in the schoolroom in the tongue, protruding from between the lips as a mark of concentration that is also a profound unawareness of all else that is around. Carelessness and care, carelessness with and of care. As an advance notice, let me say that care here, firstly, is the Dutch word zorg. Concern, worry, anxiety, uneasiness, alarm, care, nursing, provision, maintenance, service, supervision, control, surveillance, administration, management, guardianship. Translation moves from language to language, transcription from page to prattle, transferal, transposition, transportation. Through all this, of Walter Benjamin's insistence in the seventh of his theses on the philosophy of history, that there is no document of civilization that is not also a document of barbarism. As the knot tightens and slips, what is seen is the extent to which barbarism could hide or screen or divert attention from barbarism. This will be not a single melodic line, but a montage. It is necessary so, since montage, as Moten points out, renders inoperative any simple opposition of totality to singularity. It makes you linger in the cut between them, a generative space that fills and erases itself. There are many exceptional characters in the pages of Tahinda Jess's OVO. Among them are conjoined twins, singers, musicians, and entertainers, Millie and Christine McCoy, pianist John William Blind Boone, pianist Blind Tom Wiggins, and pianist and composer Scott Joplin, who Jess, in a blizzard of alliteration, describes in his list of the cast or elements of his OVO as ruler of ragtime, professor of piano prestidigitation, saint justification, ace of ivory 88s. Later on, we meet Joplin's wife Lottie saying, he was the king of ragtime. Something they call jazz out of each instrument, smearing it all across the world's war-torn face. They were their own force. They were, as their music declared, on patrol in no man's land. Wherever we went, they sprayed the landscape raw with syncopation. They lugged their saxophones and grins into crowds of refugees and bombed out cities, and somehow made them seem to forget. They were heralds of a terrible necessary transformation in the world, and they bade all who heard them to swelter that change into their bodies as they moved in its sway. In short, their music seemed to me to be a makeshift binding on a wound that did not know how to heal. A funhouse mirror, an altered lens that took all the world had known and turned it inside out, rupturing it from remembrance. A mask upon a terrible visage. Reading Jess Trotter's description of the sounds of and from and in and around the mud-bathed battlefields as a syncopated jazz dance of death and slaughter, I am, as one-time dutiful student of art history, struck by the way echoes and clashes with Filippo Tommaso Marinetti's frantic free-word sound imagery of similar scenes. Words in freedom, Marinetti calls the approach, Arrowe Liberta. Jettisoning punctuation, eschewing standard grammatical structure, jamming fragments of song together with snatches of stewed radio chatter, together with sounds of battle organs, rendered on accurately together with number and mathematical symbols. He spreads the score across the page, laying it out in a diversity oriented, typographically various, breathless tumble that gathers up and hurls. Voices of Trotter, crushed by the sight of men blown to bits. Gunner, head shattered, covered a gun with his body, pulp, putrefaction, flies. Behind him the server, a shrapnel in his hands. Embraced the open caisson, full of gold, safe. It was singed by the sound of trumpets bent to war. Scenes of smoke, forests and doors, hay, mud, manure, smell. There's no more feeling in my frozen feet. The smell of mold, rot, gongs, fruits, cowbells, pipes, everywhere. Marionette is on a latter, the sounds of shell and rocket and bullets, the art of noises that renders the sound of the fired ammunition as it flies through the air, lands, explodes, delivers its death blow, and echoes off and around the features of the surrounding landscape. This is where I, dutiful student of art history, came in. Art history of the canon, of the rest, of our geographical culture, cultural, social, political landscape, described by Henri Baraka in his poem Black Dada Nihilismus as a grey, hideous space. Sylvia Winter, in interview with Proud Flesh, picks this up. I read where Leroy Jones, Amir Baraka, in his wonderful Blues People from 1963, said that we need to look at the West from a landscape outside the West. And she said to herself, I'm an Occidental, and that I tried to study the Occidental from a place outside, although I am in it as well. This sound of light from the canon in the canon is what I have known and heard for decades. That's sang. Even before it became monetized and publicized in the Big Bang 80s as a label by the book. Sang! 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 Toom! Toom! Sang! Toom! Toom! Words in freedom. Freedom from what? Freedom to what? In what freedom? With whom? In what freedom? In the madness of war, Marinetti wrote in rejection of orthodoxy. I was in an aeroplane sitting on a fuel tank, my stomach warmed by the pilot's head, when I suddenly felt the absurd inanity of the old syntax inherited from home. Raging these free words, releasing them from the prison of the Latin period. He wrote out his experience of the Battle of Adrianople in 1912, in the First Balkan War. Adrianople, the Dune, named by and after the Emperor Peter. It was in that part of the world that Hadrian met Maximus, Wilkes, Soas and Eurocani, who was to die, sacrificed himself in the Nile and become identified with Osiris, god of the underworld, the transition and resurrection, whose body was dismembered, scattered across Egypt by his murderous brother Set. Isis, in her search for the first fragments of Osiris, remembering Persephone, Roman Proserpina, carried off to the underworld by Greek Hades Roman Pluto, and condemned to its own end for the winter months each year as a consequence of her having eaten four of Pluto's proper pomegranate seeds. And now here's another folding back. Marinetti breaks out of the Latin prison house, out of the third restrictive declension of Carcere. Out of the culture. I'm softening this. It was given to me hard, always good, never joke. A magister, a master, always good. Discourse on the logic of language. English is my mother tongue. A mother tongue is not a foreign language, languish, anguish, a foreign anguish. English is my father tongue. A father tongue is a foreign language. Therefore, English is a foreign language, not a mother tongue. Searching for her own mother tongue, for the possibility of a mother tongue, Norma Se Philip returns to Latin, to the story of Ceres and Proserpina, a mother in desperate search for her abducted daughter. In the opening poems of her collection, she tries her tongue, her silence, and soft voice. Foreignness is at the root of her entry into poetry. She has spoken in an interview about the strangeness of growing up. Talk to the beauty of the daffodil, but to her, entirely unknown power. How does the object that is the poem sound in such strangeness? This is what returns in the spring. This is what you love. This is what you will love. This is what is to be loved. This which returns to the underworld, trumpeting itself to God. This encounter in your lonely wandering is how you express your love of what is to be loved. The waves dance, but this that you will love outdoes the sparkling waves with me. The words are strings in the mouth, the images and ideas attached to them so much fantastical flimflam. I gazed and gazed, but little thought what wealth the show to me had brought. How can the tongue work under such conditions? It's a question insistently and repeatedly put in Meditations on the Declension of Beauty by the Girl with the Flying Cheekbones, in the last part of which Norma Se Philip asks, In whose language am I? Am I not? Am I? I am yours. Am I not? I am yours. Am I? I am. If not in yours, in whose language am I? If not in yours, beautiful. And this couplet that titles the collection, She tries her tongue, her silence softly breaks. She tries her silence, her tongue softly breaks. Tongue breaks. What echoes here is the dumbstruck figure in Sappho's fragment 31, lines explicitly referenced in Universal Grammar. Fragments, brief as Sappho's, tremble the tongue on the brink of X, when the passage of sound is completely blocked, the consonant is called plosive. Here is Anne Carson's translation of fragment 31. He seems to me equal to gods, that man, whoever he is, who opposite you sits and listens close to your sweet speaking and lovely laughing. Oh, it puts the heart in my chest on wings, for when I look at you, even a moment, no speaking is left in me. No, tongue breaks, and thin fire is racing under skin, and it eyes no sight, and drumming fills ears, and cold sweat holds me, and shaking grips me all. Greener than grass I am, and dead, or almost, I seem to me. She burns, is crazy and sensible, for she is in terror or almost dead, so that no single passion is apparent in her, but on the rest of her, and her selection, as I said, of the most important elements, and her combination of these into a whole, becomes excellent. And Carson concludes, Sappho's body falls apart, while Giants' body comes. Universal Grammar, nor to say Philip parses the word fragments. Fragments, common noun, neuter gender, plural number, third person, object of verb remembers, remembered fragments, did not hold. Trading company and its insurers over whether the murder of 133 people by throwing them overboard was a liability to be borne by the trading company. loss due to the negligence of the captain, or by an insurance company, a loss of cargo necessarily jettisoned in an effort to save a stricken vessel. Zong, the ship originally meant Zorg, but which became transformed through an error in its repainting. In the notanda to Zong, Norbusse Philip quotes from "She tries her tongue, her silence often breaks." Oath, moan, mutter, chant, babble, curse, chortle, ululation. These words, she writes, would metamorphose into intelligible speech to chart the outline of a wound. And she goes on, in song, the African transformed into a thing by the law, was retransformed miraculously back into human. Through oath and through moan, through mutter, chant, and babble, through babble and curse, through chortle and ululation, to not tell the story. In her book, In the Wake, on Blackness and Being, at the start of chapter 3, The Hold, Christina Sharp writes of North St. Philip's poem. It is in and with the ripping and art of language that song begins. Language has deserted the tongue that is thirsty. It has deserted the tongue to those captives on board the slave ship Song, whose acquisition of new languages articulates the language of violence in the hold. The tongue struggles to form a new language. The consonants, vowels, and syllables spread across the page. The black letters float like those Africans thrown, jumped overboard, and lost in the archives and in the sea. This is the other tongue, not the mother tongue. This is not my story, which is to say, not my story to appropriate, not my story to tell and or to not tell. Is not my story to tell. Anagrammatize history and lyric, rendering ostensible coherence into what Susan Miller might call fruitful incoherence, to unarrange every given sequence, shift stress and emphasis off the beat, to resist that given in the space. further pressures my own assumptions is that in encountering Julius Munro Trotter and searching out paths into and across Baraka's grey, hideous space, is the fact that as part of the necessary work, I return to Marinetti's Paolo de Libertà for a refresher in the poetry of words and freedom. This time, I'm reading not the collection of futurist manifestos edited by Umberto Apollonio and published by Thames and Hudson in the World of Art series in 1973, but a much newer translation from Yale University Press issued in 2002. The striking thing in this more recent book is that in rendering Marinetti's stream of linguistic fragments into English, the translator has worked not only on the identifiable words, but also on the onomatopoeias. What in Italian appears as zang, tum, tum, becomes in English zong, tum, tum. Zong is the sound of death as it approaches in English. Zong, 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 tum, tum. Writing in rejection of orthodoxy, Yun Song Kim draws on the brutal energy of futurism's regime of martial hygiene in her Gospel of Regicide, a collection of poems in which she confronts the acquiescence of her community. In the presence of monstrous racial brutality, turning a blind eye, and in front of this collection, firstly, the poem, A Love for Violence. A Love for Violence. Intoxication of futurism. Mysterious feelings, a body of velvet, asexual manners, morals in a tin box reflecting colours similar to a dry, cleaned rainbow, a thrown away image pulls apart years, hiding nothing but ellipses. Farewell, my heart, we are barely enough remain. The desire is, as Kim says in the poem Translating Lineage, to refashion your lineage in a moment of danger. The poem's starting point is the Korean threat, uttered in order to command obedience, that any violation of expressed wishes will be followed by the transgressors being removed from the family record. They will become unattached, a non-person. The accuser will remove the accused. The poem ends. The act of denying the father is to peer into one's records and situate first the enslaved and then all others. And lastly, the poem that immediately follows A Love for Violence. They're part of the second half of the book, which is called The Gospel. The poem, too, is called The Gospel. Treachery, the love it requires, its militancy, its gendered formations, the woman, the vengeful woman, the woman in love, the woman who hates. How, when she appears, there are no questions. We just say, oh yes, ah, her, yeah, we know her, take her away. I want to write an ode to her, and how becoming her is the only goal in a resurrected life. Note here that it's in the start of line two, and it's at the start of line three are different. It's militancy, no apostrophe, is a quality of treachery. It's, with an apostrophe, gendered formations, is the beginning of a description of the nature of treachery. Our issue, says Winter, is the issue of the genre of man. It is this issue of the genre of man that causes all the isms. And we are going to have to struggle for an entirely new definition of what it is to be human. Except in struggle, there is no more beauty, says Marinetti. Not beautiful, terribly beautiful, says Mingus. My desire for regicide, says he. My desire for regicide, my desire for the throne to be empty, unseated always in my presence. Thank you. the appendix, Jess offers some Barker's notes on the circularity of syncopated sonnets. We can read interstitial, imbricating, interweaving line and line as we work down the page. We can read interstitially and anti-gravitationally, interweaving line and line, overlaying and overlaying as we work up the page. We can read diagonally down, jumping side to side as we descend, then read interstitially as we defy gravity and ascend again to the top. Strike your own path through their lines, yes, circle round their stories to burrow through time.
So many questions spring to mind, but I want to begin with a practical one. How did you do it? What was the process of preparing this?
I was reading Olio, and it was, I think, as I said in the blurb, which Kristen sent round, it was that little excerpt that I read out that triggered a kind of recognition, or sort of skewed recognition, and I kind of wanted to follow it. I think part of it is that, I don't know whether in spite of everything, all of the associations that we all might have with futurism, with you know, the politics of that's bound up with it all, I still, when I read some of that writing, I am enormously thrilled by it. But as I say, as I'm thrilled by it, I'm also aware of, as I said in the piece, a kind of ridiculous safe distance that from which I'm able to deal with this. It is words on a page, it's not sitting in a trench while this but that sense of a kind of radical reworking of what's been offered, of refusing a straightforward kind of request to continue in a given line, that's something that I find still quite interesting. I was reading that, and then the other things I also read, Yunsong Kim's Gospel of Regicide, Christina Sharp's In the Wake. And I think out of reading Sharp, going to Norbert A. Phillips' poems and reading those, and somehow they came together. And I didn't quite know how when Kristen asked me to do something.
You found they compelled you to question your own position as a speaker?
Yeah, I suppose it would be important to say that for this, I mean, what I said, what happens, everything that happened here is entirely understandable as something that is an event in an academic institution. But it's about what's possible within the institution, what the task of those who work within the institution might be, how that is established and written down in a contract, but which is endlessly undermined and questioned by those who are delivering mm-hmm. on that contract. And absolutely, I can't feel myself ever to be in the position of being able to say, it's like this. I can only say, how is it, given this and this, and knowing that there's that and that that I have not and will not encounter.
Some time ago, I did a sort of performance lecture on shame at the Royal College, in which I performed a kind of abject shame in front of the audience, and then threw that into question, because is it possible to perform shame? And to perform shame is kind of like the absolute control. So, I mean, this is the sort of paradox of throwing your own position into question. If you do it, it's the ultimate position of authority.
Yeah.
So I'm really asking how you avoided that, and was the way that you worked with Morgan and Hannah a way of doing that, and if so, how?
Well, we spoke about that, and when you say how did I avoid it, I'm obviously not entirely sure that I did,
okay.
And possibly I didn't at all. But we did talk about that. I mean, we did a kind of run through, and maybe it's also worth saying that I don't know either of them very well. We've only ever really encountered each other in a teaching educational context. I had never heard either of them play drums when I asked them to do this. I simply knew that they did.
Mm-hmm.
And they practiced together on a number of occasions, getting some sense of how they might work off each other and together. And then when I came in and we started, of course, they acknowledged that things shifted slightly because, you know, Teach was in the room with them. And so I talked about this, and inevitably it's inescapable. You know, I am who I am, and they are who they are, and the positions are different. And yet, I did make it as possible as they, you know, as I could, to say to them they could do what they like.
So, did you rehearse, or how much was it improvised? Do you want to say something about that? How you approached it?
I don't think we rehearsed. We played together to sort of get a feel for how we should have played. It wasn't rehearsed. So
I spoke about this to. I spoke about this to Michael because what I was struggling with was that to a certain degree everything that I'm playing, even if it is improvised, it's always rehearsed on some level. So similarly with this, I wanted to rehearse sort of sections or little sort of games we would play between us or something to then work in, and so we, you know, acted more as a unit in conversation with Michael rather than just, you know, between us.
So, I mean, were you improvising with, or did you see yourself as having a disruptive role in relation to what he's saying in some sense?
I think it kind of fluctuated between the two.
It did, yeah. I think that's what was most obvious when we were practicing on our own together, because we would play quite loud and we started to understand we're going to really undermine what Michael's saying at some times. You know, he would come back and say, that's probably a good thing. But when we practice today, I think,
I mean, I really asked that because I was also at, maybe some of you were at Michael's inaugural lecture in which he asked people who had been undergraduates, is that right? To provide objects and sound as well, and somebody else to provide images without knowing what Michael was going to say. So introducing into this authoritative position, you know, where he would sort of profess his professorhood, a form of disruption, it seemed to me it was really important that it was by others and not a sort of auto-disruption.
That wasn't, actually I selected the images, but I didn't refer to them, except sort of tangentially. But I did ask someone to provide some kind of, I think probably I just said, look, I want you to fuck it up, and I don't want you to tell me how you're going to do this. And of course, the same problem arose, although actually I was extraordinarily moved by what he actually did. I mean, they're very small things, like, you know, a group of people timed to walk in after I'd started, just so that, you know, what was the beginning where this thing started was. There was a fake fur coat, there was some, you know, buckets of ice cubes, so like the atmosphere, the environment was made as part of what I was saying. There were those kinds of things, and he did mess around with the warden's introduction. He mic'd up the stage and then whacked the volume up so that every time the warden breathed, everything went and the warden just, who didn't know what was happening, and of course everyone else was fighting their time. Anyway, that was, but yes, and maybe it's a kind of ridiculous smugness on my part that I'm saying I don't want to, or it's a kind of sort of perverted coyness that I'm trying to deal with, or something like that.
Can I ask you about the necessity to do this now? You know, what is the necessity for this disruption? I mean, in some ways it's obvious, but I wonder how far you want to go with that.
I think it seems to me actually crucial to do it now. There are all kinds of levels at which we're at a real kind of point of problematization or something, I don't know what the right word would be. Institutionally, there's a kind of ridiculous, overbearing, wretchedly interfering regime being imposed upon higher education. All kinds of demands to satisfy certain requirements which actually have so little to do with what one is attempting to open up as a space of possibility for people who are here. All of those things restrict that, divert you from allowing that or making things possible. That all of the larger cultural questions that are in play, they also are hugely relevant and pressing upon the situation. And so, I guess what I'm saying is, I mean, the other thing, like, you know, like it is half a century since I was smashed around the head being told how to speak Latin, but, you know, so that's a long time ago, and all of those things that I've assimilated, all of the art histories that I've learned are, it does seem to me, for all that I love so much of it, not adequate, just not adequate. And it, however good all of it is, it's only ever as good as you can make it for yourself at the moment that you're making it for yourself.
I mean, we recognize now how far that education that we both had 50 plus years ago was part of a legacy of colonialism, as well as a legacy of war, actually. I mean, I was sort of thinking about how many of my teachers had gone through the war and were quite traumatized in in some way. So it's very different generationally. But in terms of that sort of colonial aspect, I mean, a lot of what you did tonight was to do with black writing and relation to language.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I was wondering how much the way that you responded to that, articulated it, and performed had to do with how do you, as a white man, relate to that, deal with it, express
yeah.
your own position in relation to it.
Yeah, and I suppose all of what I was saying was, I do not possibly have an answer to that question. It is a question that I have to persistently, and I do persistently, ask myself. But I do not have an answer, but it is a question that I want and need and feel the need to continue to ask. I mean, even, for example, I mean, you used the word black, and the word black appeared in on a number of occasions in the text. Now, on no occasion in the text did I use the word black. The word black only ever came from quotations from other writers that I was introducing, and that seemed really important to me. And in terms of, you know, like what I was saying about even the story of Zong, you know, which really, as even Norbise Philip says, like I can't tell this, and if she can't tell it, I certainly can't tell it. I mean, even that, just like that first line of the first Zong poem in the book, I was kind of hesitant to actually to read out. But it's that, you know, I did want to turn that line of Rankin's round, like it wasn't a game, it was a lesson, on and say it to myself. Because that's, you know, I am the one who's having the lesson.
I think that's a good point to open it up to your questions and points you might want to make. Do you take the microphone around?
Yeah.
To me, it seems like you're illustrating and evoking black oppression, black pain in your performance, because you're, like you just said, you're quoting the words of black writers and theorists, and you're talking about the massacre of Zong, yet all of that is drowned out with the drumming. Was that your intention?
No, I think certainly it was, I definitely did deliberately ask Morgan and Hannah to be here to make noise so that what I said was not straightforward and simple and easily and clearly hearable, that I'm not the one who's giving the lesson, as it were, that there is a lot going on, and whatever is there is for everyone to find what they can from it. I think that the one thing that we did do, which you probably noticed, was that whenever I was quoting a poem, I walked forward and they stopped, so that it was only the poem that was being heard, and then I stood back and they started playing again. That was one thing for me. But I think that issue clearly is one that, you know, is being discussed, and I'm, you know, aware of it, and I read as much as I can about it. And I, as I said, it's not, you know, I don't want to be presumptive or appropriative or, you know, in any way, you know, to kind of squat on anything. But at the same time, I do think for myself that it's necessary to acknowledge that this is something that is unquestionably in the space in which I have to live and work, and must be, you know, included in all thoughts and acts.
Any other?
That you drowned it out with white drummers? Why did you get black drummers?
I think, I don't think that's right.
It wasn't a,
no.
I got it on the wrong track.
I don't
right.
think that's, no.
But I suggest it as it would be a way of sharing.
Can you use
the burden of what you were trying to say. I've finished. There's a burden, a certain burden that we carry. Sorry, I've finished. Someone else. Why?
Didn't hear your question. Could you repeat your question?
Sorry. Why were the drummers white and white people were drowning out, except when you read the poems, but basically drowning out the things you're trying to pass on? And I probably missed the point.
No. There was a paragraph early on when I made that reference to Benjamin and the thesis and philosophy of history when I mentioned the line about documents of civilization being documents of barbarism, and barbarism is a good mask that defers and deflects from barbarism. And if there was any kind of sense in which the totality was doing that, then that would be part of it. I mean, we did again talk about the fact that there would always be, or there would necessarily be moments where what I was saying was going to be drowned out. And I'm quite happy with that.
I wanted to bring the conversation a bit towards the theoretical sort of notions of drumming. Like some people like might be acquainted with John Lewitt, write about the fantasy in drumming, like fantasy that's activated in the process of drumming. And there, for me, in the work that you just presented, seemed to be an element of fantasy there. And there was a lot of themes coming through, like abject, themes of objectivity, themes of sort of the threat of death, themes of those we've talked about, Zong, and there was a lot about femininity. And I'm just wondering more in your opinion, as a situated sort of commentator on these subjects, do you think on a personal level that the synthesis of your words and the drumming kind of brought about some form of fantasy that you have for certain sort of sequestered cultures?
That's very interesting, and that may indeed be something that I wasn't aware of that happens. And I'd be quite prepared to believe that that is something that people understood was happening. I think I'm slightly more cautious about your use of the word synthesis. I think when we were talking about the setup, we were quite conscious of the degree to which there may be moments where they're both playing, you know, and they're in the same rhythm, and what I'm saying, somehow the words seem to fall on the beat as well, so there's some kind of coherence. But equally, that would so often fall apart, that there would not be a synthesis, that there would be a clash, the one of them would do something and the other one would cross it, or, you know, the ride would be hit at exactly the moment I said a word and then therefore it went. So some sense of like a total synthesis was quite importantly not there. I mean, even to the extent that in one of our earlier conversations, Morgan was saying, you know, even just like doing a paradiddle or something on the, you know, on the snare, you know, I'm already thinking like rat-a-tat-a-tat in Marinetti, and that's a real problem for me. So how do I get out of that? You know, I don't want to just like, you know, whack the pedal on the bass every time you say tum or something, you know, just as a way to kind of to make sure that we're not dealing with some kind of image and caption or text and illustration or something like that, that actually it is going to be not a synthesis but a number of different elements, and not simply just the different elements in the text but also the different elements to the ear that don't fall into place, don't, you know, have a pattern, that, you know, it might be awkward and uncomfortable and annoying, or God, I wish they'd shut up, or he'd shut up, or something. You know, they'll vouch for the fact that I've said that on a number of occasions in our conversations, that, you know, I would be prepared for quite a large amount of antipathy. So, yeah.
You mentioned Marinetti again, and you talked about Scott Joplin in the trenches. So the context of war comes up, and I was actually wondering what the relation of the performance to that context is. I mean, are you implying that we are in a war and that is the context for what you're doing in some sense?
I think that I can't remember the precise words that Jess uses about, you know, make your own path and then connect across time. But that, you know, that book came out a year ago, and I was reading it this, you know, last summer gone, and that is the, you know, that's the thing that brought back to me futurism, and that immediately calls to me to think about a refiguring, I suppose, of high modernism, of like, what is it? You know, like last year, I'm not doing it this year, but often I do a kind of series of weekly, just like lunchtime things. And anyone who wants to bring their sandwich or their pot of noodles or whatever, they come and we talk. And last year, I did just that. I did a kind of thing on high modernism, like one where we talked about cubism and futurism and so on. And because really just to say, what is that? What is that now? Like, what do we mean? Or what does it mean to us? How can we use that? You know, what can we draw from it? And there is that. And obviously, you know, in an important sense, we are always at war. There is war. And very often it's just like a, you know, a small item on down the page on, you know, whatever newspaper website you go to. But on the other hand, it's, you know, like the destruction of Syria, you know, Yemen or something. I think I've gone. I've disappeared.
There's always another. Any other? I think we have time for at least one more question or comment, if anybody has one. Any takers? Otherwise, I will thank Michael, Morgan, and Hannah for this evening.